Welcome to Matters Financial and Geopolitical from the Frontier, and thank you for stopping by. If you haven't read my piece that I wrote over the weekend, The Year of G2 is Europe Off Balance, do take a look at that. It sort of covered many things, sort of a big macro outlook, really. I'd like to thank His Excellency Bob Godek for the invite yesterday to his very viral Tweet for Elephants event. Richard Dawkins piled in, the thing started trending in Washington. It was really quite exciting and quite a coup d'etat. And he told me, you know, we have this sort of unit, he was describing how they can monitor elections. And he said, you just put that equipment to work on this, and it worked very effectively. I then, this morning when I woke up, I saw this tweet from the real Banksy, whom I follow, Nature in Street Art, located in Cape Town, South Africa. And I couldn't resist it, it's of an elephant, and it's very arresting. I posted a photograph of a single elephant that I took in the Amboseli, I got there yesterday evening. It was really viral, fascinating, having all these great elephant fanatics in the room in one go, and we even had time to dance to a song composed by Giuliani and Emmanuel Jarre and others. One of the best comments the ambassador made was that the best time to act on a problem was 20 years ago, which I thought was fantastic. Other themes that came out is that China holds the fate of the elephants in its hands. This was Ian from Save the Elephants. Esmond Bradley Martin, who's been tracking the prices, said ivory has spiked from $750 per kilogram to $2,100. And that was, I think, 2011 to 2014. And the point I made was that if you look at commodity prices, the best performing commodity prices anywhere in the world are ivory and rhino horn, one and two, which is... And then Ian Douglas Hamilton was telling me, but don't say that because everyone will then want to do a bunk, or want to put the squeeze on it. And I said, well, I'll say it, and then I'll remind everyone of Nelson Bunker Hunt, and they tried to squeeze the silver market. I've gone tangential. It's an important issue. I feel very strongly about the elephants. And it was great to catch up with Ian Douglas Hamilton again. I got his book, Among the Elephants, which is a fantastic book. He was out of university, I think. And he just lands in Lake Manyara amongst 500 elephants. And it describes, early marriage. He flies a plane to propose to his wife in Navasha. Fabulous book. I'd read it many years ago, and I said to him, you know, you're a legendary fellow in my mind. And must commend Paula Kahumbu as well. Very, very effective. As I said, my piece over the weekend was The Year of G2. And, as Europe of Balance, I don't think I'm wrong. I took this photograph at 6:44 a.m. from my office room, from my office of Nairobi as the sun rose. I hope you like it. Smith in Africa is tweeting that Julius Malema said the AU is toothless and is led by the wife of the toothless president of South Africa. There is no vision, no African agenda. Pretty powerful stuff. I like this photograph of Pope Francis touching down in Sri Lanka. I'm a great admirer, I must say. Haaretz tweeted that Putin will not attend Auschwitz memorial ceremony due to Ukraine tensions. Turkey's Erdogan, and in this photograph he's on the right, this is from Bloomberg, received Palestinian President Abbas after passing between two columns of 16 troops, each dressed in the warrior regalia of past Turkic states, bearing period armor, toting weapons ranging from swords to lancers. A pretty extraordinary photograph. An ISIS clip claims to show a young boy shooting supposed Russian spies. I'll put up the photograph. The independent is saying, the militants say the men are now in the custody of the lion cubs of the caliphate before the child steps forward and appears to shoot the men. And that took me back to, well, these young girls that they're using in Nigeria, it's just truly appalling. And William Butler Yeats in The Second Coming, turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. Things fall apart, the centre cannot hold, mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all convictions, while the worst are full of passion and intensity. The World Bank released a big semi-annual report. The global economy is at a disconcerting juncture. This is the World Bank chief economist, Basu. It is as challenging a moment as it gets for economic forecasting, which is a fair point, and I think that's all around this new normal, this arrhythmic normal, this geopolitical intersection with economics. The global development lender predicted the global economy would grow 3% this year. This is a downgrade from 3.4%, which they predicted in June. This is their Global Economic Prospects Report, in-depth, worth looking at. Global economic prospects to improve in 2015, but divergent trends pose downside risks. We grew 2.6% estimated in 2014, and they're saying we could see an expansion to 3%. I think that's going to be tough. I think the US will be very strong, Europe will be very soft, Japan will be in the middle. Risks to the outlook remain tilted to the downside due to four factors: persistently weak global trade, possibility of financial market volatility, extent to which low oil prices strain balance sheets in oil producing countries, risk of a prolonged period of stagnation or deflation in the euro area or Japan. Risks to the global economy are considerable. Countries with relatively more credible policy frameworks and reform-oriented governments will be in a better position to navigate the challenges of 2015. In sub-Saharan Africa, growth picked up only moderately in 2014 to 4.5%, reflecting a slowdown in several of the region's large economies, notably South Africa. Growth is expected to remain flat in 2015 at 4.6%. The outlook is subject to significant downside risks arising from a renewed spread of the Ebola epidemic, violent insurgency, as I call it, the insurgency tail risk, lower commodity prices, major inflection point, not going to bounce quick, Angola and Nigeria to suffer. But though later on in this report, they're very sanguine about Nigeria, saying that the service economy is now worth a great deal. I don't agree with them. Shift to spending increasingly productive ends, infrastructure constraints are acute. Euro last trading around the 118 level, reached a December 2005 low of 117.53, from which it bounced. It's now around the 118 level. I'm a bear. I think we're going down to parity. Dollar index 92.13. Japanese yen 117.15. Could improve further. Swissy 101.85. Pound. That's been all over the place. They printed an inflation number of 0.5% in December. We saw it fall sharply below 151. We're now back and at around 152. So it's been a stupendous bounce. Caught shorts on the hop, I think. Aussie 0.8089, India rupee 62.125, South Korean won 1081.52. That got a nice bounce, didn't it, over the last few sessions? Rial 264.22, Egyptian pound official rate, of course, different to the unofficial rate, 715. South African rand 1156.30. Dollar index, I'll put up a 3-month chart. I'm a big bull about the US. Mary Lou Carnevale of the Wall Street Journal posted a tweet saying that the US Treasury posted a $2 billion surplus for December, making the 2014 deficit the smallest since 2007. I called the US economy the comeback kid of 2015 over the weekend. I said the Federal Reserve has stopped printing dollars. The Fed's just one headline economic print from raising interest rates. A rate hike, even as small as 0.25%, will be the catalyst for a renewed surge in the dollar. The dollar index is headed a lot higher. I said, buy the dollar. euro dollar. As I said, 118 area looking for parity. Commodity markets, crude oil, I'll put up a 5-day chart, $45.90. I think we're going way below 40. Brent so far this week has lost 7%, US crude 5%. As I wrote on the weekend, I think oil could average $50 a barrel for the next 24 months. I don't think there's any Hail Mary pass coming. The oil warfare specialist Obama has wrestled crude below $50 and effected a chokehold on Vladimir Putin's Russia. And then Venezuela, which was apparently going cap in hand to Qatar and China over the last few weeks for money, Nigeria and Angola. Nigeria and all shares been taking it on the chin, and it's down big and the worst performing stock market in the world. I'll also put up a 1-year chart. I think we're still going lower. Gold called that wrong, 12.2719. And what's happened is you've got much lower yields across developed markets. And since gold does not pay a return, an opportunity cost for holding it is the yield foregone on safe haven bonds. Now that cost has diminished to the point where buying gold offers the same return as lending money to Germany for 5 years. Think about that. Copper suffers meltdown. This is a big issue for Zambia, I'm afraid. Copper futures dive 6.2% to $5,499 a ton. When major chart support cracked and triggered a host of stop-loss sales. The metal is often considered a barometer of industrial demand, so the slump lent extra gravitas to news that World Bank had cut its 2015 growth forecasts. And then repeating that very unsettling comment from the World Bank chief economist Kaushik Basu, the global economy is at a disconcerting juncture. It's as challenging a moment as it gets for economic forecasting. Frost HK tweeted, copper goes into free fall. I'll put up his image. Certainly captures my attention. Coming to sub-Saharan Africa, the link for the World Bank sub-Saharan African Outlook is under Rich Wrap-Ups. Just scroll down. And then I've also linked the entire report there. I've just been through it, scanning through it. Growth picked up moderately in sub-Saharan Africa in 2014, average of 4.5% compared with 4.2% in 2013. Growth slowed down in South Africa. Growth also strong in many of the region's low-income countries, Cote d'Ivoire, Mozambique, Tanzania. If you exclude South Africa, the average growth for the rest of the region was 5.6%, faster pace than any other developing regions excluding China. Regional GDP growth projected to remain steady at 4.6% in 2015 and rise gradually to 5.1% in 2017, they're saying. The risks to the region's outlook are mostly to the downside, stemming from both external and domestic factors. A range of idiosyncratic risks include the Ebola epidemic, expansionary fiscal policy and currency weaknesses. And this is the important one, the precarious security situation in a number of countries. A sudden increase in volatility in international financial markets, lower growth in export markets are among the major external risks to the region's outlook. I think the risks are of a different quantum than they were last year. I think in Nigeria, the insurgency and Al-Shabaab, which just seems to settle down a bit over here, but Nigeria is just becoming worse as far as I can see. And if you look at it just on a geographical map of where the writ of the state runs, it doesn't run over most of Africa. And that is eroding in the last 12 months. The Madagascar cabinet quit on criticism over living conditions. So economic growth slowed to a standstill after the coup, and the World Bank last year estimated 9 out of every 10 people in the country of 22 million. Lives on less than $2 a day. South African All Share had a strong session yesterday, up 1.99%. It's now negative 0.64% for the year. Dollar Rand 11.56.43. Egyptian pound official rate 7.14.78. The Egyptian stock market bounced 2.19% yesterday. That's, I think, the best performing stock market in Africa, up 4.32% so far. Nigeria, worst performing stock market in the world, is now down 13.76% so far this year. There is an article on Reuters where the US spokeswoman Mary Harf said that the February 14th presidential election should go forward despite the violence. Interesting that she had to say that. Nigerian Islamists push girls to become suicide bombers. Last month, 13-year-old Sahara Babangida refused to set off explosives she was carrying after being sent by her father. God. To camps run by the Nigerian Islamist militant group Boko Haram. God, don't have children, my God. Babangida was arrested by police on December the 10th after two other female bombers killed at least six people at a textile market in northern Nigeria's largest city, Kano. She agreed to travel from Bauchi to Kano after the militants pointed at a ditch and told me that I'm going to be killed there if she refused. The members asked me if I wanted to commit a suicide bombing and that if I did, I will enter paradise, said Babangida, who was wearing the flowing religious garment that covers the body from head to feet, known as the hijab. She was paraded in front of reporters on December the 24th. Young girls are being increasingly coerced into suicide attacks in the predominantly Muslim north as Boko Haram evolves tactics in its six-year campaign to bring Islamist rule to Africa's largest economy. In the past week, a girl as young as 10 set off explosives at a market in the city of Maiduguri, killing at least 20. Boko Haram relies upon women and children to carry out suicide bombings because they can easily and effectively infiltrate crowded urban environments and bypass security checkpoints without arousing suspicion. It highlights the ability of Boko Haram to access, indoctrinate, and utilize all elements of society. It is very shocking for someone to take a child that they bore as a biological father and recruit her to commit suicide. The point, and then this is the final point, the proliferation of violence in the pre-election period is leaving the Nigerian security forces spread too thin. There is little doubt that the government and the military have effectively lost control over large swathes of northeastern Nigeria. Ian Bremer tweeted, killed by Boko Haram in Nigeria 2009, 700, 2010, 750. 2011, 600, 2012, 1650, 2013, 3000, 2014, 7700, last week, 2000 plus. Timor Nabili, who's a friend of mine who used to be at Al Jazeera and is now at CNA, tweeted, "Are women the new terrorist weapon?" with a photo of Boumediene. I spoke about this insurgency tail risk a while back, and I think it remains, and how it plays out will have an important consequence for ourselves and the entire Africa Rising narrative. Boko Haram's leader, Abubakar Shekau, has already taunted good luck by saying, "I'm in your city." And for me, this is the real problem. The Nigerian Central Bank has loosened rules for trading its currency. The maximum net open foreign exchange trading positions banks can hold at the end of each business day was increased to 0.1% from zero, the central bank said. So, it's not going to make any difference. The point is, it's a false market. And I still believe in what I tweeted 19th of November when I said the currency heads to 200, the central bank does not have the firepower. Ghana Stock Exchange is negative 0.05% this year. Banks in Zimbabwe cut 1,000 jobs last year. That's 1,000 out of 6,000. That's as good a signal as any. World Bank is forecasting a 6% Kenya GDP expansion this year. So that's relatively constructive. Tullow Oil will be a smaller company, a source tells Reuters. Oil companies across the globe are grappling with a drastic drop in oil prices that has hit earnings. Tullow will be a smaller company. They employ 2,000 people across 22 countries. Cut capital expenditure this year to $300 million, down from $1 billion. And I wrote about this on the 17th of November when I spoke, dwindling oil fortunes, not good for Kenya. I said, you know, my concern at this moment is this. We're necessarily placing a big bet on oil and gas and cementing our position as the pivot, the energy conduit and route to the sea state for this region. Now go take a look at the price of oil. This was in November. At that point, tallow oil was down 45 or 46%, Africa oil down 60%. They're down even more now. Now we're saying the markets are signaling loud and clear that the economics have changed and how. Both tallow oil and Africa oil are exploration companies. And now we're saying it's imperative for the majors to step in, and I don't think it's going to happen. Kenya shilling, very soft, 91.397. Nairobi All Shares spiked 1.67% yesterday, and it's gone positive 1.15% year to date. Safaricom was the big precipitator of that move, rallied 6.137% yesterday, and that was on the occasion of Bob Collymore's birthday, which I thought was rather good. The NSE 20 is up a half of 1% this year. Mumia Sugar Company is the best performing share of the stock exchange, up 31.578% year to date, and it's up again by about another 10%. Kenya Airways is putting up for sale 3 billion shillings of prime Embakasi land, which is near the airport. Dr. Turner tweeted some great photographs from Mount Kenya, Point Lenana at sunrise this morning on top of the world. Another photograph of sunrise, and I'm going to put up a photograph of I took of the snow peaks of Mount Kenya, seen from the slopes of the Fairmont Mount Kenya. Ethiopia dam will turn Lake Turkana into endless battlefield. This is the Guardian. People living near Lake Turkana have little understanding that the fresh water essential to their development is likely to dry up when a huge hydroelectric dam in Ethiopia is completed. Fishermen, farmers, teachers and others living near the world's largest desert lake say Turkana's volume has reduced significantly over the past 30 years because of higher temperatures and changing weather patterns. Few of the 100 people interviewed by a Kenyan researcher for International Rivers Watchdog said they had been consulted or warned about what could happen when the reservoir of the Jibe 3 Dam, one of Africa's largest hydropower projects, is completely filled in about 3 years' time. $1.8 billion construction project, 90% complete, will start limited power generation in June. Downstream impact of the dam is hotly contested. Some hydrologists have predicted that Ethiopia's expansion of water-intensive sugar and cotton plantations on the Omo River, which the Jibe 3 dam allows, could reduce flow to Lake Turkana by up to 70%. If the Jibe 3 dam is constructed, the lake will dry up and this will lead to desertification. There will be depletion of resources, there will be no fish, no farming, and low humidity and less rain. If that is the case, the community will be finished, said Sylvester Ikariman, chairman of the Council of Elders in Kalakel Pastoral Village. I'll put up a photograph I found of the Lake Turkana sunset, which I rather liked. As I said, the All Share surged 1.672% yesterday. Safaricom lifted the All Share, rallying 6.137% on the occasion of the CEO's birthday. Equity turnover remains subpar, and yeah, I was thinking to myself, you know, all this uncertainty around the capital gains tax means some people who are long might not be prepared to sell it till there's more clarity, and that might have reduced the supply side of the market, therefore firming it up of late. Mumia Sugar was a zero in 2014, but has ramped 31.578% higher this year. As I said, Safaricom, very strong session. 15 is a record high, all-time high from December. It's up 4.62% year to date. It's headed higher. KCB, very strong yesterday, up 1.77% to 57.50. Less than 5% away from a record, headed there. Centum was the most actively traded share. Of course, they're going to bag a very solid gain from the sale of their stake in UAP. And they had some good news on the Lama coal project, so I think that supported the price higher. Once again, I appreciate the fact that you stopped by. If you ever want to just plug yourself into the Nairobi stock market, just register on rich.co.ke, get a password, come back to us if you've got a problem, and then go to Rich Live. During trading hours, 9.30 to 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Kenya time, we transmit live stock exchange data. You can see how the market's doing, and it's been pretty interesting this year, hasn't it? Once again, we're all now waiting for the ERC, going by the language and the interviews they've given, I can see they're not going to give us the full benefit of the cut. Let's see how much they do. Once again, thank you.